Well, great. Thank you. It's really a pleasure to be talking to everyone here. I hope you can hear me okay. I will just be taking a few minutes and walking you through today's topic, COVID-19 testing data and surveillance. And this is related to research in my lab. We've been working on developing rapid diagnostics for a while, including things like HIV diagnostics, as well as work here in the US with an FDA-approved blood test. And when COVID-19 came, we have been also working on that. So I might touch a little bit on what we have been doing in the lab, but mostly I think I will talk just more generally about COVID-19 testing, where it stands right now, and where it may go in the future. And really, these are the hot button issues that I plan to cover in the next period of time. And the first thing I will point out is that there are two different types of tests. Probably most of everyone here knows that. But the two types of they're very different tests. They give you different information. And I'll walk you through this one at a time. The first one is a test that looks directly at whether or not you have the virus. So whether or not you're actively infected. And they're typically done through a nasal swab or a nasal pharyngeal swab. Some of them are being offered as saliva tests now, but for now I'm going to refer to these as swab tests. And then the second group of tests, which you probably have also heard a lot about, are antibody tests. So this is not a test that looks at whether or not you're carrying the virus. It's looking at whether you have been infected with the virus in the past. They're both useful tests, but they give you different information. One, whether or not you're actively infected and carrying the virus. The other one tells you whether you have been infected with it in the past. And I will walk you through this one at a time and go through some of these questions, which are ones that are typically out there right now. Before I get into the details of this, this is a paper that our research group published. I show you the reference on the bottom right, talking about diagnostics in general. And it's certainly been interesting to see how this COVID-19 testing has really gone from 0 to 60 in the past few months as an example of a new diagnostics test that has had to be developed from scratch, and now with the idea of having it be implemented at a scale that's probably beyond any other diagnostic test. And so we're really going from one end to the other in terms of how fast that development and validation and implementation has to take place. And what I have what I'm showing in this diagram is really a bunch of factors, a bunch of things one has to work on in order for that to happen. So at the top are technology sort of issues, and there's a number of them that are different. Some of them are developing the test itself, the chemistry and so forth. Some of it is the fluidics. Some of it is the instrumentation. And then, of course, the data analytics as well. And then you have to integrate it all together. So really developing all those pieces together in a short period of time, technologically putting it together, that's what one has to do right now. And then the other side of this is the sort of the non-technology pieces, the clinical workflow. This has to be something that works either in a lab setting or in some other setting. Maybe eventually these tests will be done outside of a lab, right in a doctor's office, maybe even in your home. And so this has to be considered. The reimbursement issue, who's actually going to pay for it? And that has been a discussion point here as well. Regulatory guidance, FDA has been very involved, and legislation even in terms of what the Congress what their role should be, and all of that has to come together to get a new test to the market. And one thing I'll just point out here is there are really different settings for doing diagnostic tests, And the way you would do it, the instrumentation involved would be very different depending on where you're doing that test. So on the upper left might be something where we have a centralized lab. So this would be a lab. This is where most of the current tests are being done. The samples are being sent back to a lab. So you have a reasonable infrastructure, and also the cost is relatively unconstrained, in that you can have big testing instruments, that's okay. The other end of this is if you're doing things in sort of the field setting, maybe even in the consumer's home, and also you don't want these tests to have to cost a lot. You never want it to cost a lot, but when you're asking people to be purchasing it and so forth, it really has to be very simple to use. And so you have to think about these constraints and what that means in terms of the design are also actually pretty different. So you will be seeing a range of diagnostic devices and instruments. And you have probably read about some of them in the press already, but this is something to keep in mind, is that there are actually different types of diagnostic instruments for different types of tests, depending on what the test is and where you're using it. So let's maybe jump to the first issue here, which is the swab test. And again, it could be a saliva test, but really the point is we're looking directly at the virus. And again, there's a bit of a trade-off. These are some of the tests that are out there on the market, but as of a couple months ago, it's a little bit old now. This is how fast these diagnostics are moving. But the point is they typically, there's a bit of a trade-off in terms of the time it takes to perform the test and the throughput. So highlighting again what I was just saying, it depends on which setting you're running these tests. If we're talking about a lab, the tests that are typically run right now, actually just maybe looking at the top here, is a big sort of instrument. Roche and Thermo Fisher sell a couple of them that are being used in big testing labs. It could be hospitals, it could be public health labs, for example, run by either the national or the state government. And some other labs also have their own machines, but typically they purchase a machine from these big instrument makers, and they would run this this test. And then the bottom one shows you something that could be done at the point of care. So in sort of a field setting. I'll come back to these two types, but let me just talk about the test first. So what we're doing here is we are looking at whether or not you have the virus directly, typically in your nasal tract. On the left is a schematic of the virus. This is really just any coronavirus, but it also includes what the latest one right now, SARS-CoV-2, which is the virus behind COVID-19. So what you can see here is, again, on the left is a cartoon. The virus you can see here, it's got these proteins on the outside, which are called the spike proteins. On the right here at the top is an electron micrograph of this virus, and you can actually see those spikes. That's what gives the name to this family of viruses, coronaviruses, like a crown. On the inside is actually what I want to point out here. The inside of this virus is the genome of the virus that carries the genetic code. This virus carries that genetic code in the form of RNA, ribonucleic acid. And so typically what these tests do is they would, when you do a swab, you would then break open the virus and you would amplify this RNA. And you can maybe at some point look at other parts of the virus if you're doing a virus detection test. But typically these tests right now look at the RNA. And the reason is that you can do an amplification reaction of nucleic acid. So even if you don't have a lot of viruses around, you can run a PCR test to amplify the number of copies so that you can really try to detect the virus even if it's at low levels. At the bottom right here is a graph. This is from the earlier Chinese patients, but it's the same here for anyone, anywhere really, is that if you're looking at the viral load, so the amount of viruses you have in your nasal swab is on the y-axis. On the x-axis is the number of days since symptom onset. So zero would be when you have reported a symptom. That doesn't mean that's the day you've been infected. In fact, it's not. That's just when you report a symptom, if you're even reporting a symptom. And so these are patients who went to a hospital because they reported a symptom. And what you see with the viral load is you're actually starting off really high. So by the time you feel any sort of symptom, whether it's a fever or a cough or anything like that, you can see that you're actually, your viral load is high. And then, so you're already developing this, you actually have a pretty high viral load already. And then it tapers off over time. So you can imagine what it would be like before you have symptoms. Okay, you're starting off high. It's not like you have symptoms and your viral load goes up at that point. By the time you have symptoms, your viral load is already very high. So that's one of the reasons that this virus has really spread. It's a little bit unusual that you can be that asymptomatic but be that infectious. So it's a little bit insidious that way with this virus. Now, so what we want to do is we want to catch whether or not you have the virus in your nasal tract, either asymptomatically or after you have symptoms, to see whether or not you have the virus. And I pointed out a couple of instruments already. This is the one that, and they work reasonably well. So there are some issues with false negatives, for example, that have been pointed out, that sometimes with the lab tests, for example, with those big instruments, sometimes even though you are positive, that they don't report you as positive. That's called a false negative, because it reports you as negative, but it's not true. You're actually positive. You know, that's a limitation sometimes in terms of, it could be for a number of reasons. It could be because it's that swab or that sample just didn't have the virus, even though you carry it, and no test is perfect. But I think they're generally pretty good, these tests when run in a lab. The more of a challenge are the tests that are done at the point of care. And this is one that was also in the news because it was the one that was being used at the White House, for instance. And then they found out that really they miss maybe a lot of the positive tests, maybe even up to a very high percentage. And so there's still some limitations right now in that these tests are still, there's a lot of opportunity for improvement, let's put it that way, for offering tests that could report a result in just a few minutes. This one, for example, from Abbott, could report a result in between 5 and 13 minutes, but actually there's some questions right now that it's missing a lot of positive tests. So. So that's kind of where we stand on this, that you have the tests available. And of course, there's another group of tests right now where you can, saliva tests are being offered. There's also potentially you can collect tests at home with a swab test and actually then send that sample back to a lab. So you're not getting the result right away, but at least you don't have to go to a phlebotomist and get your blood or get a swab done. You can just do this at home, but then days later get the result. I think, you know, a lot of us are trying to develop a test where you can get the result right there on the spot. This is just work that we have been working on, and we have a startup company also working on this, where we can really have a very simple workflow and offer this instrument. This instrument, we're positioning it to be just very low cost. The Abbott instrument earlier costs over $10,000 per instrument, and then each test also costs money. So our instrument here will be much, much less, probably a hundredfold less in cost. So we're trying to develop a test like this. So I will move to the antibody test. And this is a different type of test. And so what is the availability, and then and then the immunity issue I will also try to address here. So first of all, just explaining what this test is, very different from the previous tests. This one is typically a blood test. It is a blood test right now, although people are also trying to work on a saliva test for this, but it's mostly a blood test right now. And it's looking at not whether, it's not detecting the virus at all. It's looking at your immune response to the virus. So whether or not you have developed antibodies to the virus. And what that would tell us is whether or not you have been infected with the virus. How this works is every time you're exposed to a virus or any foreign agent, your immune system starts developing an immune response, including antibodies. It takes your body a few days to develop this. So even by the time you report symptoms, as you see on the right here, which is again, not even infection. Infection is before this. So it takes your body maybe, 10 days or, 2 weeks, something like that, where you would start developing antibodies. And what we can see here, there's two different groups of antibodies. There's more than two, but shown here are two. There's one called IgM, which your body develops first against any foreign agent, including SARS-CoV-2. And then IgG comes later. IgM comes first, but dips off earlier. IgG comes just a few days later, but stays high. So what this means is, even during your infection, if it's possible that you're already showing positive for antibodies, but then afterwards, after you clear the infection, the IgG levels actually will stay high. Okay, so having an antibody test positive doesn't tell you whether or negative doesn't tell you whether or not you're currently infected. If you're currently infected, you could test positive or negative, actually, depending on where you are in the infection cycle. But then after you've recovered, your antibodies would stay high, especially for IgG. So that's what typically we look for. And now there's data showing that basically everybody develops an antibodies towards SARS-CoV-2, which is the case for almost all viruses anyway. So nothing unusual there, unless you're immunocompromised, you're going to develop a high, a detectable antibody response for the most part, and that will tell you whether or not you have been infected in the past. Now with antibody tests, there's also three different types, which is sort of similar as before. There's a lab-based test. These are blood tests. They're being offered by places like Quest or LabCorp or just other lab services. These tests are pretty accurate, okay? So there's never really been a question of whether or not they are accurate, meaning are they sensitive or specific. Sensitive and specific means the rate of false positives and false negatives. And those tests are generally very accurate. Home collection kits might also be moving into the forefront as they are for the other tests, swab tests, but these would be blood tests. I don't think they're being available yet, but they might in the future. And then there are these rapid tests, which are like the pregnancy tests that are in becoming available for the antibody tests. So these are different groups of tests. The lab tests actually are pretty accurate. The ones that you might hear about are not so accurate are the rapid tests that are like the home pregnancy kinds of tests, okay? So when people are saying the antibody test, there's some concern about the accuracy. It's not the lab test generally, okay? It's these rapid tests. And I won't go into the history of this even in the last few months, but basically the FDA had to claw back the way they were doing this because there were too many rapid tests being offered, not directly to consumers, but to providers that basically were flawed. And so that's now being rectified, hopefully, and some of them it's a better situation now, and hopefully some of these tests might actually be available to homes, meaning at some point, none of them are available right now to consumers' homes, but at some point, maybe you can run a pregnancy test format for doing an antibody test to tell you whether you have been infected in the past. I wanted to throw this out there. It might be too much information, but there was a report a week ago that said up to half of antibody tests are false, and that is just wrong. That is a wrong headline. That is not what it says. I'm probably going to skip this due to time, but basically it relies on a bunch of assumptions. It's referring to something called a positive predictive value, that if you test positive, are you really positive? It is a statistical truth, but as we know with statistics, there's, you know, various ways of interpreting statistics. So, so really, I don't think it's an accurate way of depicting really anything. It's just a statistical and not statistical observation that you can argue for anything that has a low prevalence. It's not a useful way of looking at this, in my opinion. So the bottom line is the when you do a blood draw, send it back to a lab for antibody tests, those are still very accurate. These pregnancy strip tests are becoming validated and will probably be available at some point, even to consumers' homes. These are ones that we're making in our lab, of these rapid antibody tests that are based on blood tests. And what we are also developing is a paired mobile app that will help consumers run the test properly. Actually also has a scanning algorithm, so you can scan the rapid test image. It'll give you an interpretation of that result for you, because when we're releasing these tests to so many people at home, this has really never been done before in the history of diagnostics. We have done something like this for HIV already. So we're developing a home rapid test for antibodies as well. And then we're also developing an app that could be paired to help consumers run this test. So the last topic I'll tackle is this immunity issue. And what does this mean in terms of getting people back to work? And this is the bottom line here, is because there's also questions in the press that you might hear about, well, we don't know if antibodies really show whether or not you have immunity. And I'll hope to show you in the next couple of minutes that actually the evidence is very, very compelling that there is immunity for almost everybody if you have been infected in the past. And really the question at this point is more how long your immunity would actually last. This slide here and the references are shown at the bottom right, which you can dig out if you want to read more. This is an early study in China with just a couple of macaque monkeys. These are just monkeys, but still they give us information that if they have been infected in the past, that if you infect them again, re-challenge them again with the virus, their viral load does not go back up. So their viral load spikes with the first infection. You challenge them again with the virus, and their virus now does not go up, it stays low. So preliminary. Last week, actually, a paper came out in Science, which is a top scientific journal from Harvard, that really showed this with a lot more monkeys. And the last sentence here, these data show that SARS-CoV-2 infection induced protective immunity against re-exposure in non-human primates. Okay, so I think the monkey data is pretty solid. What about humans? With humans, a lot of the subjects looking at whether they produce antibodies that could actually neutralize the virus, over 70% show that. And but immunity can be achieved in different ways. It's not just neutralizing antibodies, there's other mechanisms as well. And so I think what the evidence is also showing is that a lot of us develop highly neutralizing antibodies, but really there's very few reports, if any reports, that there's reinfection taking place. A lot of the issues about reinfection came up a couple months ago from South Korea, saying that there were some patients who were infected, recovered, but then still kept testing positive, not only for the antibody test, which we expect, but for the other test, the swab test, which shows that they're carrying the virus. So that showed that maybe they were reinfected, but the South Korean CDC, their CDC, were the ones who reported this initially. This got a lot of press. But that they have done a lot of subsequent studies and basically shown that they are not carrying infectious viruses. So a couple of more recent study reports in the press that I show you here, that really that original group, which prompted a lot of this concern, really a lot of investigation afterwards by the Korean CDC show that these patients are not reinfected. What is probably the case is that there's a small percent of patients in general, when after you've recovered, you just have this virus, non-infectious virus around. It's not infectious, but it's just sort of remnants of this virus around that you haven't cleared for a little while. This is still under investigation, but right now there is no evidence that that any patients have been reinfected or have been sick or anything like that. It's very compelling evidence in total. It's not a proof, and so people keep saying there's no definitive proof, but I think every evidence points to immunity, at least in the short term, for one people who have been infected, and an antibody test will tell you whether or not you have been infected. So an antibody test is useful. The question is, how long would that immunity last? And we just don't know at this point. With past viruses, you can have immunity that would last you for decades. For many, many years. Sometimes it will wane in as short as a few months. So that is a question that is still under investigation. This is my lab that has done some of this work. So I think I'll just end off there. Happy to take questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sia. And just a reminder to submit any questions you have for Professor Sia through the Q&A box on your screen. Thank you. So our first question is, why does the viral load dissipate over time when you first show symptoms? Is it antibodies doing their work?
Yes, it's your immune system doing the work. And so most patients recover. And so when you recover, that's what you see. When you look at your viral load, it'll drop. And so that's what happens.
Can you share what enables your swab analysis machine to be much less expensive than the machine from Abbott Labs?
Right. So I think, we're using methods that are very robust, that are low cost, robust components. I think that might be the heart of it. The way we're doing it is we're actually running the full PCR test that is run in labs. And we're hoping that will show the high sensitivity. The Abbott test actually does not run a PCR test. It runs a so-called isothermal amplification test, which is really, it's less tested. It could work, but it's less tested. But Abbott is the leading diagnostics company domestically, and the third parties have shown that they are missing up to 50% of positive infections, which is not good. So I think there's some questions with these isothermal methods. Our instrument runs the true blue PCR test using a different way of doing the thermal cycling. People typically say the challenge of doing PCR at the point of care is the cumbersome nature of doing the temperature ramping up and down, and we found a way to do this just lower cost and but still very robust. So that's sort of the short answer to that.
I think you said immunity can be achieved in other ways besides infection. Can you give some more specifics? Are you talking vaccines?
Yeah, so what I was saying there was, yeah, I went a little faster, was that it's not just through antibodies or neutralizing antibodies. It's also through something called cell-mediated immunity, such as your T cells, for instance, which you may have heard about. I just wanted to show that. I probably went a little too fast because, again, there's, I think, a lot of confusion that is out there when people talk about diagnostics. And sometimes people say that, well, an antibody test doesn't really actually tell you whether or not you have so-called neutralizing antibodies, because antibodies when you detect antibodies in these tests, they're not necessarily the ones that will stop the virus from infecting your cell. So that's true. We're not detecting that in the antibody test, but that's not the purpose. The purpose of the antibody test is to tell you whether or not you've been infected. And that does a really good job of that. When people criticize it in that, well, you're not detecting the antibodies that could stop the virus, what I was trying to say was that that's not the point about what this test is, because if we know that you have been infected in the past, then the chances are you could be immune in different ways. It could be neutralizing antibodies, but it could also be through T cells. So anyway, it's a bit of a subtlety, but it's something sometimes people criticize these tests, and I don't think they are criticizing it properly. The vaccines the point of a vaccine is to sort of simulate an infection to get you to produce either protective antibodies or these neutralizing antibodies and or a T cell response. And so some of these vaccine candidates that you're hearing, that's what they're trying to do, is they're trying to simulate an infection again by for example, producing pieces of the virus so that you're not actually infected, but showing you pieces of the virus so that you're developing the protective antibody response and or the T cell response, and that way you can be protected that way. But again, you know, those who have been already infected typically would already be immune already, at least in the short term.
Do you recommend high-risk people like the elderly take the antibody test to determine if they are already immune? And if so, which antibody test do you believe is the most reliable?
Yeah, I mean, I think the antibody test is something, there's really no reason, I shouldn't say no reason, but I think, you know, if it can be made accessibly and affordably, you know, it's just a blood test. And right now it's a blood draw. I think at some point soon it will just be a finger prick. It's not pleasant, I guess, but it's not that big a deal. And it will give a lot of information. And so the elderly, I think, other high risk groups with you know, hypertension, diabetes, et cetera, and really just the population at large. It, you know, in theory, you know, I do still agree with the policy recommendation that just because you've tested positive, it's not, nothing is foolproof. So you might want to test again, you know, either way, just if you want to be safe, if you're going to really be drastically changing your behavior one way or another. But maybe you shouldn't drastically change your behavior. But I think, you know, having that information is really helpful. It's helpful from a public policy point of view if the results get reported back to a public health environment, which is now actually being required by the CDC as of 2 days ago. So that they can collect the data more comprehensively, which has been a criticism of the CDC. It is also helpful from the point of view of individual companies, institutions, as well as individuals. Again, I'm not going to recommend that people act all cavalier, you know, just if you have tested positive. I don't think that's wise. But you know, it's very useful information to know, to just know that, yeah, you know, some people have been infected and they might be okay in the short term.
If previously infected, why does the virus hang around giving a positive swab? Wouldn't the antibodies ride the virus from the system?
Yeah, you know, that's a great question. I don't have an answer to this. This is under active investigation. This is one of the active areas of investigation. The CDC is calling for states to try to identify people who are under that scenario so that this can be studied more. Don't have a great answer to that, but I think, you know, this is just something that has to be investigated. And there's other things with this virus as well that are a little bit, you know, not one would have expected originally. You know, it's causing issues all over the body in terms of what it does. It's not just a respiratory virus, for example. So really the pathophysiology, the biology of this virus, is something that is being investigated. Every virus is different.
What does the new normal daily life look like without a COVID vaccine? And how long until this goes back to normal, do you believe?
Yeah, that's a tough question. I think, you know, the other possibility in addition to a vaccine is also a drug that works really well. And right now there is remdesivir, which is not necessarily one that probably works well enough to really be a game changer. But there could be drugs along that lines. And that's what happened with HIV. We don't have a vaccine today, but through a cocktail therapy, HIV became something that people feared to something that became manageable. And not as good as a vaccine, but it was a game changer nonetheless. But until we have either of those scenarios, I think, you know, we're just gonna have to preserve some degree of public behavior, which is already being instituted. You know, I think the fact that people are practicing all these measures is having a very drastic effect. The thing about the virus is that a virus is not alive. sorry if this is obvious to everyone here, but a virus cannot replicate on its own without a host. Okay, unlike say a bacteria or other microbes. And so if it needs us to propagate, and so it's, you know, smallpox is a virus and it was eradicated. So it needs, you know, so what we do, and it needs us to transmit it to other people for it to be propagated. What we do is, you know, has an absolute control over whether this virus spreads or not. So I think, you know, it might not be the normal as we knew before, but with what we're practicing right now, we can have a very drastic effect on the spread of the virus.
We've got time for maybe a few more questions here. Are survivors of SARS-1 or MERS coronavirus infections protected against the infection by SARS-2, which causes COVID-19?
Yeah, that's a great question. I don't believe they are. I've never heard of those reports that they are. I think people have been looking at that, but I don't believe that that they are. But although don't quote me on that, I know people have looked at that, but it could be because of a variety of reasons. SARS was 20 years ago, MERS was a while ago, maybe the way immunity has faded, and also the homology. Those are coronaviruses. There is a strong homology there, but it doesn't take much to have your protection, have your immune response not cross over. You know, look at flu, for example. It's influenza every season, but even, you know, so it's actually the same same organism, but because of just some changes in the strain, you know, you lose immunity. So it could be a number of reasons for that to not carry over like that.
Are you seeing this virus mutating? And if so, how does it affect diagnostics and recommendations?
So far, this virus does not seem to be mutating very quickly in general, and it doesn't seem to be mutating into have any effect on the infectivity, positive or negative. So I think overall, we have that going for us, is that it hasn't mutated wildly. So that's a good thing. So contrast that with, for example, HIV. That's one of the reasons HIV was just so difficult to deal with. There's several, you know, more than one reason, but HIV just mutated all the time. And so one needed several drugs at once to combat it. We're not quite seeing this here with this one.
When vaccines are available, should the elderly wait until safety is proven before getting vaccinated?
This is a tough call. I mean, you know, I think Fauci just came out saying that the vaccines might actually be made available even before the safety has been completely proven. Normally, vaccine development takes a long time. A lot of it is just safety. validation, even if it has promising results. And it's hard to really short circuit that. I mean, because it takes, if you're going to really be assessing efficacy, you have to wait a while to do that on large numbers of people. So this really becomes a policy decision. And it's really hard. It's hard to say. I mean, you know, it's going to depend on the specifics of the safety profile, how comfortable people really are on that. And I think if it does show a reasonable profile there, then maybe you know, one would consider doing that for at-risk populations, even if the safety hasn't been proven 100%.
So are you investigating any of the long-term effects of being infected by COVID-19?
Yeah, that's another great question. And, you know, we're still early into this. And so so there's a lot of biologists and infectious disease scientists really looking at the long-term effects. That's something I'm sort of concerned with as well, because I think people think this one will kind of go away at some point. Well, there's other pandemics actually as well, but even just speaking of this one, what is the long-term effect? You know, we don't know. We do know that it causes other effects in the body. It's not just a respiratory virus. So we don't know. There's a lot of viruses that have long-term effects, a lot of other infectious diseases that have long-term effects. There's acute effect and there's a chronic effect. And we just don't know right now.
Well, thank you so much, Professor Sia. We actually had quite a few questions that came in that we weren't able to get to, but we are out of time as our lecture is now concluded. But I wanted to thank you for your time this afternoon and for your very informative talk. We actually got a lot of comments in the questionnaire box, just commenting that they really enjoyed hearing from you, our alumni. So thank you.
Great. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.